Welcome to Compassion Radford. I'm here with my friend Connie.
And I'm here with my friend Susie.
And we'd like to wish you a
Happy Mother's Day. As you're watching, we hope you'll fill out the Connect card. You can find the link on the Facebook or YouTube. And while you're there, if you have any prayer requests, please put those in there because we would love to pray for you.
Also, if you're a first-time person, fill out the comment card or you can put first-timer in the comments.
We're wanting to talk to you. And in the comments, there will be hosts that are people from our church, and they would love to respond to your comments. And if you have a prayer request, they can pray for you right there in the comments if you ask for that. Or you can ask for a private message for a prayer as well.
So like us, share this service. Also, comment during the service. And as always, we'd like to welcome you. So sit back and enjoy
Compassion Radford.
Your praise will ever be. on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You will be praised, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised, you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing,
found here and now, 'cause
Jesus, you change everything. Chains fall, fear bow here now. Jesus, you change everything. Lives healed and hope is found here and now. Jesus, you change everything.
Today, God, in the lives of everyone listening, God, and we thank you so much that we can sing that song, God, and know that you are the chain breaker, God, that you're the one that we call on, and that you're so holy and you're so awesome and mighty, God, and we thank you so much for being that in our lives right now, in Jesus' name, amen.
Ah, your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you.
Welcome to Compassion Radford. I want to thank you for being a part of our Sunday morning worship experience. Thank you for those who are viewing online this morning. We also appreciate you who are listening on the radio. Thank you for tuning in. I want to remind you that we have people that are live waiting to chat with you. If you've not checked in, please do so. But if you have an immediate need or a prayer request, there's going to be somebody there to assist you. And feel free during the course of this message to continue the conversation going on. Now, if you're listening on the radio and you need to contact us, you can. You can email us at radford@compassionchurch.cc. Now, this morning, you know, I want to begin this by just wishing everybody a happy Mother's Day. If you have invested in a child's life or you've been a mentor to a young person, at the end of the day, you're a mom, because a mom is about investment. You know, over the years, I think the older I get, the more I appreciate the investment that my mother took in me and placed in me. She was a spiritual example for my life. She was a person of prayer. She never gave up on me, even though I was sort of wayward at times. And over the years, I finally came right. So the moral of that is simply this. If you have a child, or if you have a child that you are mentoring, okay, never give up. You're investing in their life. Now, this morning, what I'm going to do is we are going to look at a woman who was at a devastating point in her life. She was at a crossroad, and she had to make a decision. And whatever decision she made was going to determine her future. She basically had two options. One choice was obvious. We would call it a no-brainer. The other choice was not in her best personal interest. Now, many times when we get to a crossroad, okay, there's a path that looks clear, and there's another path that looks a little rocky and dusty, and it looks like it could be filled with difficulty. So our natural tendency is to take the easy road, the easy path. But sometimes that easy path can be a dangerous trap, and that decision affects our future. Proverbs 14 and 12 tell us this: there is a path before each person that seems to be right, but it ends in death. So this morning we're going to be looking at a woman named Ruth. Ruth was a little different. She was cut from a different cloth. And instead of putting her own interests first, her decision was to take the path that is less traveled. Ruth's decision was one of faith. But before we actually get to the passage this morning, I want to give you just a little bit of background, what has happened to bring Ruth to this point. There was a severe famine in the land of Judah, and there was a man named Elimelech. And he moved his family into the enemy territory. They were from Judah, and he moved his family to Moab. Now, let me just say this. Never intentionally make a decision to move into the enemy's territory. That's not the right thing to do, and it didn't work out well for him or his future. And over a period of time, Elimelech, he dies and leaves Naomi a widow. Now, Naomi had two sons, and those sons' responsibility were to care for her. But yet, they married two Moabite women, one whose name was Orpah and the other whose name was Ruth. Now, after some time elapsed, the two sons died. It was about 10 years after their father died. And we see three women in crisis. We see Naomi, we see Orpah, and we also see Ruth. All three are widows. Their life right now is in chaos. They don't know which way to turn. But then Naomi gets wind that God is now blessing Judah. And she makes a right decision. She decides at that time to go back to her people, okay, where she probably should have been to begin with. But yet it wasn't her choice to leave. So she's going back to her people and to her God. So she begins to pack, and her two daughter-in-laws begin to pack up. They're going to go with her. And this is where we pick up in the scripture. They're on the road to Judah. In Ruth chapter 1, verse 7, the very end of the verse, we're going to begin there. It said they took the road that would lead them back to Judah. But on the way, Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back to your mother's homes, and may the Lord reward you for your kindness to your husbands and to me. May the Lord bless you with the security of another marriage." Then she kissed them goodbye, and they all broke down and wept. Now, one thing you can see in this passage of Scripture, you can see the love. Naomi loved her two daughters-in-law, and the daughters-in-law reciprocated that love to her. But Naomi, you know, as she's going down the road to Judah with these girls, it dawns on her, this might not be in their best interest. She's thinking, you know, number one, if they go back to Moab, they can go back to their mother's household. And because of their age, they probably have a real good chance to be remarried. Now, Ruth, according to historians, was anywhere from 30 to 40 years old, which, you know, which is young. Okay, and I'm not sure how old Orpah was, but probably in that same age range. But she also knew this, that if they continued on the road to Judah, that probably life would be more difficult for them. Why? Because they were Moabite women. They were the enemy. They would probably suffer some prejudice. They would probably, you know, not be accepted so much by the community and have opposition by the locals. So Naomi goes on to explain, I didn't put the scripture on the screen, but she goes on to explain to these girls, trying to encourage them to go back to their mother's home, to go back to Moab. She's saying it's going to be better for you. And she said, you know, by the way, you know, basically, I'm old. I can't have any more children. And even if I could, by the time they grow up, your life pretty much is going to be over. So you're going to be better off to go back to Moab. These girls were at a crossroads. Okay, to be honest with you, it makes sense to me, if I was in their place, to say, hey, I think I'll go back to Moab. All right, life is going to be easier there. It's going to be less difficult there. But yet they were at a crossroad. They could take another path. Now, one of the roads was a rocky road. One of the road was filled with difficulty and challenge. The other road that was intersecting was smooth, and it seemed to be paved without any difficulty. So the ball was in their court. Now let's go to verse 14. In Ruth 1 and 14, the scripture says this, "And again they wept together, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye." When Orpah got the chance, when she looked at the two roads, she said, "Bye, Felicia, I'm out of here. I'm going back to Moab. I'm going back to Moms. I'm going back to my gods, because that's going to be the easy path." And she takes off and goes back home. But Ruth made a decision that wasn't really in her best personal interest. When we are thinking from their perspective, she was going to take a path that was not going to be easy. It was going to be difficult, it was uncertain, and it was full of challenges. Ruth decided to take a spiritual path. She decided to take a step of faith and go to Judah. Now we see in verse 16 that Ruth said this to Naomi, "Don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God." Ruth made a spiritual decision. And you can see in her words faith declarations. She was saying, "I don't care how difficult the path may be. I want to be one of your people." Who was Naomi's people? God's chosen people. She said, "I want your God to be my God." She wanted to worship the Most High. She wanted to follow Naomi's God. Now, that says something about Naomi. Naomi must have imparted something to her about her God that was received into her heart. Ruth decided to make a decision that she would put her trust in that God. And we see next, it's not in the scripture, it's in the Bible, but not on the PowerPoint or the monitor. But we see a picture of Ruth is clinging to Naomi. She's not wanting to leave her, but I think we also see something else in that illustration. As she was clinging to Naomi, she was clinging to her faith. And there's many times that you and I, when we make a decision and we decide that we're not going to go back to Moab, we're not going back to the old way, we have to cling to our decision and we have to stand in faith. You know, I can remember at the age of 39, I was at a crossroads in my life. I had two paths I could take at that time. I felt the call of God on my life beginning to draw me. I was a football coach for 15 years. I had time invested in the system. I had time and money and education invested in education and in coaching. I was in a very good situation. I was in a school system that was the highest paid west of Richmond. They paid their coaches well. I had a great teaching job. I got student teachers every year. I'll be honest with you, I had it made. It was the best situation I could have ever asked for. I was in a successful program. We had great facilities. And when God began to tug at my heart, that path to stay in coaching and education, let me tell you what, all I had to do was grind it out 15 more years and I would have retired. Well, I could have retired 8 years ago. I could be sitting on Myrtle Beach right now looking at the waves coming in. But at the end of the day, I had a decision to make. One road was smooth, but there was something, there was an intersection. And that was God's intersection in my life. He would put me at a crossroads. You have the decision right now. You can take this road or you can follow me. And let me tell you, when I looked at that road, I'll just be honest with you, straight up. I mean, it was scary. You know, it was uncertain. I didn't know what my future would be. I didn't know where I would land. I didn't know about how I was going to support my family. But I had to make a decision. And I think I made the right decision for myself and my family. Ruth made the right decision. Moab would have been easy. But going to Judah was going to be tough. And I want to say this about Ruth. We can all learn a lesson, male, female, from this woman. This woman had grit. She had gumption. Let me tell you what, when she made her decision, she never looked back to Moab. She clung to her faith. She stuck on the road to Judah, and she was willing to grind it out. Did she make the right decision? Well, I cannot take you through all four chapters of the book of Ruth today. But I would encourage you to go read the book. Four chapters, that's all it is. You can probably read it in 20 minutes. A lot of beautiful stories in this one big story. But in Ruth chapter 2, we see her gleaning some fields. And the work wasn't easy. I want you to picture it. Here you have a Moabite woman. You have her following people that are harvesting in a field. She's got heavy clothing on. Her face is draped. She's in the heat. She's in the dust. She's covered with dust. And she's digging in the dirt for scraps. See, Ruth was willing to begin with meager beginnings. Sometimes when you take that path, it's difficult. And your beginnings with God can be very meager. This woman's first assignment was to go into the field and pick up the scraps. It was dirty work. But the one thing that she continued to do, she continued to serve, and she continued to serve without complaint. She was serving her mother-in-law faithfully. And let me tell you, anytime you do anything through serving others, when you serve others, you're serving God. You can take that to the bank. And because she served God without complaint, she served her mother-in-law, Boaz, the owner of the field, he shows up. And the Bible says something, that Boaz notices her. Now, the first time I ever read that years ago, you know, I sort of took it in the way that Boaz saw this good-looking woman in the field. But once I picture it correctly, all she saw was somebody dirty, covered with dust, bending over, and picking up scraps. I don't think that was very appealing. But what was happening right here is God now was getting involved. Because Ruth was willing to be faithful. Because Ruth was willing to start in the field, gleaning scraps. And she did it without complaint. She was serving her mother-in-law. She was serving God. God now got involved. He honored her faith, and he honored her obedience. And he ignites something in Boaz. And Boaz notices her. Another thing that I really love about this is that Ruth wasn't man shopping. She wasn't out there in the field trying to make something happen. She was just being faithful. She was gleaning and serving. So God steps in. And let me tell you, that's what faith does. Faith invites God into the picture of possibility. Because of that, Ruth now finds favor with Boaz. God ignites something in him. He is now giving her favor. And to make a long story short, Ruth found, after she found favor with Boaz, Boaz became her kinsman redeemer. What Boaz did is he went and bought a property that was owned by Elimelech's family in order to have the rights to purchase the field and marry Ruth. He redeemed her. And in that, we see a perfect illustration of what Christ did for us. That Christ came to purchase us, that we could be a part of his greater body, that we could become his bride. As we move on into verse 13 of chapter 4, we see what happens. Eventually, it says that Boaz took Ruth into his house, and she became his wife. And when he slept with her, the Lord enabled her to become pregnant, and she gave birth to a son. Let's, for a moment here, before we close, recap her faith. The first thing we see about her faith is this: faith takes the path less traveled. She didn't look for the easy way out. The second thing we see is that faith places their sole trust in God. From the very beginning, when she made her decision, she told Naomi, I want your God to be my God. I want your people to be my people. And I'm going to follow you to Judah no matter how difficult it's going to be. The third thing we see is simply this, that faith serves without complaint, even in the midst of the difficulty. She was honoring God, honoring her mother, and she was just doing what she could do. She did in excellence where God had her in her beginnings. And because of her faith and because of her obedience, the results of her faithfulness was simply this, the supernatural entered in. God entered into the picture. We see first God intervened in the natural realm. He gave her favor with Boaz. Secondly, God blessed her through Boaz, even before Boaz married her. Boaz made sure that she was provided for and Naomi was provided for. She was no longer picking up scraps. They were giving her some of the first cut. And then we see third that God redeemed her through Boaz. What another blessing. That because Boaz loved her, he was willing to redeem her that she could become his bride. And fourth, God opened up her womb and gave her a son because Ruth had been barren. But there was a greater blessing, a fifth blessing. And we're going to see that in verse 17. It says, "Now at last Naomi has a son again. And they named him Obed. And he became the father of Jesse and the grandfather of David." Now you might be thinking, well, why does it say that Naomi got a son? I thought it was Ruth. It was. It was Naomi's grandson. And because Boaz was a kinsman, the name would continue through generations. But I want you to see who was in his lineage. Jesse. And then David. Number five, Naomi was blessed. This is the biggest blessing. Because Obed was in the lineage of Jesus. Now think about it just for a moment. What if Ruth would have decided to go back to Moab? Well, let's just talk about it a moment. I don't think that God would have struck her dead. To be honest with you, if I'd have stayed in coaching, I don't think that I would have been under a curse. I don't think anything bad would have happened to me or my family or my children. I think I'd have probably coached out 15 more years, possibly retired from coaching. I could have lived pretty good life. But yet that wasn't God's best for me. So many times we take the easy path. We take the obvious path. But it's not the best path. And we miss out on what God really has for us. Because he has something better than mediocre. He has something better than just punching the clock. He has something better than retirement. I can remember when I was making that decision, people came to me and said, "Man, you're crazy, throw it away. You can minister to kids, you can be an influence to kids, you can still work in your church, and then when you retire, man, you know, you can go for it." But that wasn't what God's best was for me. Just like it wasn't for Ruth. Ruth could have gone back to Moab, gone to her mother's house, gotten remarried, and served her old gods. Now she would have paid for it in eternity. But yet at the end of the day, here on earth, she could have lived a normal life. But God didn't call her to a normal life. He called her to an extraordinary life. The woman who began gleaning the fields in faith ended up owning the fields. And she ended up giving birth to a son who was in the lineage of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. I think Naomi made the right choice. So let's finish up this morning with our next steps. Number one, well, let me preface that. I was told this week that I need to change that from next steps to action steps because our church has next steps. So I'm going to be changing them to action steps. So don't let that confuse you this morning, next steps. They're action steps. Number one, make the spiritual decision. When you're at a crossroads, especially in a difficult time, don't be lured by what looks easy. Make sure that you spend time with God and seek Him. We have the Holy Spirit to direct our life. He'll guide you into the right decision. And if that decision doesn't look smooth, if it looks uncertain, but you're hearing Him in your heart nudging you that way, you need to make that decision, because that's where you're going to fulfill your destiny. That's where you're going to experience God's best. The second thing, step out in faith. Just as Ruth was clinging to Naomi, man, cling to your faith, make the decision, have some grit, stick with it, and don't look back. Number three, serve faithfully. Whatever God calls you to, despite the difficulty, serve Him faithfully. It may not be pretty at the beginning, but when you're serving Him out of faith and obedience, let me tell you what, He sees that, He will honor that, and He will elevate you. Four, do not try to make something happen. Be patient and let God make it happen. Our tweet of the day is simply this: when taking the path less traveled and you want to quit, be faithful and just have some grit. Ruth did. And we need more of that in the body of Christ. We need more people that don't look back. They're going to grind it out. They're going to have some grit. They're going to step out in faith, and they're going to be faithful. Maybe today you're on a path that you thought was a clear path, an easy path, and the right path. But where you've sort of found yourself, now you may be thinking, I took the wrong path. The path wasn't quite what it promised. But I assure you this, sin never delivers what it promises. It's always going to disappoint. Today, I want you to make a spiritual decision. I want you to make the right decision. And I want to see you change your destination. And it might just begin with a relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe you're at a point in your life that it just hasn't worked out. You've done everything to make it happen, and it's only ended in disappointment. You followed many different paths trying to get fulfillment, and at its end, there's a void, there's a vacuum, and you feel empty. Today, I want to encourage you. The reason you have a vacuum, the reason your life is not fulfilled, is because you need Christ to fill the vacuum. Once He fills that vacuum, He's got a destiny in mind for you. I don't care how old you are, how far off the path you may think you are, He can take you off that path and put you on the right path. And He can elevate you. And today, if you sense God speaking to your heart, just be obedient. Just respond to Him this morning. I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you pray this prayer with me and believe it in your heart, today Jesus will come to live in you. And today is going to be a different day. He's going to put you on the right path. Let's pray. Father, God, those that You're working in right now, and I believe that You are, You're stirring hearts. People who don't know You, and they don't understand why they have no fulfillment. They don't understand why they're empty inside. And they've chased many things trying to fill the void. And it always ends in disappointment. Father, today I pray to Your Holy Spirit, just begin to woo them, speak to them. And if that's you and the Holy Spirit is knocking on the door of your heart, man, you're sensing something stirring on the inside of you, that's God. He sees you. And today you've got favor with Him. Pray this with me. Father in heaven, today, I confess my sin. I know that I need you, and I ask you to come into my life and fill that void. Fill me with your Spirit. Today, I make Jesus Christ my Lord. And Lord, you created me with a destiny. And Lord, that's the path I want to be on. Direct me, speak to me this day, that I can live a life of fulfillment and glorify you on this earth. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, if you prayed with me, you can go to the comment section on Facebook or on YouTube and just say, I prayed with Pastor Hal. We want to help you with your next steps. You may need to be water baptized. You may be in California. We'll figure out a way to do it. All right? No matter where you are, we'll figure it out. But you may need to be water baptized. You may have been water baptized as a child. You may, you know, and you may be just, you know, thinking, well, that's fine, but there are other steps. You need to be discipled. You need to get connected. And we want to help you with that. This morning, I want to thank you for your giving. I want you to know that we're still the church. And I want you to consider to give if you haven't. The Bible says this in 2 Corinthians 9 and 11. You will be enriched in every way, so you can always be generous. The Scripture is telling us simply this, that generous people live enriched lives, and they are enriched by God. When you give to others and you give to meet needs, God sees it. He'll ignite it. And he'll bring increase into your household. So if you'd like to give this morning, you can go to the giving link. Just click it. It's very easy, very simple. Or if you would like to mail the check, you can mail it to Compassion Radford, 1820 2nd Street, Radford, 24141. We thank you. We pray you have a happy Mother's Day. Enjoy the day. And have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
And as Pastor said, if you would like to partner with us through your giving, the link to give is in the details of this post. Also, we have an app. If you'd like to give, you can text Compassion Radford to the number 77977.
Or you can mail in a check to our mailing address, which is 1820 2nd Street, Radford, Virginia, 24141. Again, that address is 1820 2nd Street, Radford, Virginia, 24141.
Make sure you like and share this post. And if you're a first-time guest, let us know before you sign off. Otherwise, have a great Sunday and
Happy Mother's Day.